I'm a stalker.
You're a troll.
Did you see the Miley Cyrus naked stuff?
Yeah, I love that.
Cool.
How did that collaboration come about?
I started working with her after I met this amazing kind of her collaborator, Diane Martel.
Oh, yeah.
He's a video person.
I actually video-hoed for one of their videos.
Right on. Yeah, so Diane and I just kind of started to work together, and I got to do a lot of the stuff for that tour.
Mm-hmm.
And then, the kind of just keeping up with them was able to stay collaborative with them. Miley was able to do a voice for the last episode. And, she's just really amazing, so it's really easy to kind of stay in that creative loop because she's a genius, and so is Diane.
Yeah.
And I'm able to help celebrate their amazing shit they're doing. So that's a huge honor and opportunity. I love how this is.
Yeah, but it's actually read that line. I also want to know, like, how did you get involved with Whitmer?
Absolutely.
The dear, peculiar boy.
I was, very early on with Stone Quackers, I just had the idea that it was two ducks. And, I had done this drawing of a duck with, like, a red hat on and a little duck with, like, a gray bean. And I had no idea who it was about or who was going to do the voices or what the show was. And then one day, like, Wig and Clay walked in literally off the street to this building we had, and Clay had a little green hat on, or a little gray hat, and Wig had a red hat on, exactly like the duck drawing.
Yeah.
And I like held up the deck drawing and held it against them, and they were the exact ducks that I had drawn.
Uh-huh.
And they were like, yeah, we do this amazing comedy thing called Power Violence, which is weirdly like the updated Paper Rad version of comedy. You know, it's like very experimental, almost noise, chaos-based stuff, but I feel like it's some of the funniest stuff I've seen out here. And we just got to talking and working a little bit together, and it was clear that we could build this world for Stone Quackers really easily, having some shared experiences and kind of a shared sensibility and comedy and in our approach to like making DIY shit. Because it was like, you know, pre-YouTube.
Yeah.
Which was crazy because it let us do these videos and these ideas almost in an old school way. Like that, there was a lot more impact and meaning when you would make like these objects like a DVD or a mixtape. And certainly we had a URL, which is like people would actually type in a URL as paperrad.org. And I don't know, I think we had like a trillion hits. I'll still meet people, I mean a lot more people I feel like were in the weird zone of seeing this work at that time than are like watching TV these days even. It was like such a crazy, centralized, amazing time for weird art to happen on such a huge scale.
I thought it was just amazing how impactful it's been with that whole internet art movement with all these kids now. Because I just think the way you actually use color and the pixels and all that type of thing, kind of all these kids now, it's so definitive of the atmosphere of the art that's coming out of all these kids.
Yeah, it's interesting, right? And it's also, there's a little bit of like chicken or the egg because like I didn't necessarily have this approach or palette inherently. Although being a kid of the 80s, you kind of are pre-programmed to gravitate to like extreme crazy video game stuff and neon BMX and surf and skate culture certainly contributed to it, but also when you sit in front of a computer, just the default way of creating color and shape and line lends itself to this language. So yeah, it was a crazy culmination of, you know, crazy people at Apple and hackers and post-hippie dudes making these tools, and then at the same time, post-hippie surfers figuring out skate culture, and obviously like music and everything was colliding at that time. And even international stuff, like you think of like the first wave of Japanese animation and fucking Transformers and G.I. Joe and all that stuff just invading literally a child's mind. It was like being alive in Paris in the 1850s. Or whatever the cool time was to live in Paris.
It's always a cool time to live in Paris. So, I wonder where a lot of these waited.
I'd say around like 2004 or 5. Mm-hmm. It's also interesting that you're using Flash, because Flash is a program that came out like the day I went to college. And now we've created this, yeah, definitely PlayStation. Now we've created a huge animation studio that's essentially using the same program that's been around now for 30 years.
It's really true. I feel this is like the same effect of the Japanese kids staring at it and getting serious. It's great.
Yeah, the Paper Rad is like, also like, it's funny, using animated GIFs, like we thought animated GIFs were going to just be like this thing that, no, I mean, even when we were using them, they were already cliche, they were already outdated, rather, passing. I mean, Jesus Christ, if animated GIFs just don't keep coming back. They can't back, they won't die.
What do you think it is about these GIFs that are so effective and kind of always keep it always coming back?
Yeah, I think that, I think the overly intellectual idea is that it speaks to the very nature of the processor and the computer and the pixels and the way image and the way data is represented with these images and file formats and graphic user interfaces. And I think that once things like Oculus Rift or VR or wearable technology, whatever, start to redefine our interface with the computer and how, what, where, why we live with it. But then maybe you'll get past things like funky animation and bright colors and animated GIFs. So until then, it's a very effective way to unlock the keynote. It's like using like garlic in cooking, I think.
It's the GIFs of base.
Yeah, it's the rare plot.
It's the primal, I feel like it's like the primal intenseness of it all that like is so effective with people viewing it as well as like, you know, the way we see it, it's repetitive and it's kind of getting us into a simple headspace as well as the simple technology behind it.
Yeah.
We were actually originally trying to approach Samsung to work with Oculus tech filming, and it would have been like really crazy.
Yeah. These are actually good. Maybe.
And I guess
it's because the music's good.
What was the prompt? Or were you trying to go more towards a...
We saw this one kid did an 8-bit music video for... So he did an 8-bit remix to his whole album. And our friend Mumble Boy did one, and I was like, what? If he's doing one, we have to be able to do one. And so we just somehow emailed, I think, Mumble Boy or someone, and he hooked us up, and we ended up doing 3 of these right in a row just because we were having so much fun and probably charging way too not enough money.
Yeah.
I think they paid us very fairly. This is pretty fucking badass. This stuff weirdly led to, I was able to do some work for M.I.A.
Which one?
What did I do? Oh, I kind of did this, right?
Oh, I didn't know that. Yeah, I was more familiar with the Beck videos.
This is good. Yeah, fucking A. This is good.
Super new rave type of
space. Oh, well, it's funny. Literally, her main collaborator
Harry
was...
Harry Mudding?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
no, that was what
rave.
I was going to say,
that's
you guys
rave.
Were
yeah.
like, so...
Yeah, I mean, that's everything.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
She's, like, infinitely more on top of that stuff, and, like, I'm just really fucking blessed to have had the opportunity to even meet these people.
Yeah.
But obviously, like, again, you know, this is actually good. You know why it's great? Because it's great editing, it's great cinematography, and my stuff is just the icing on the cake.
Yeah.
And it's a language that plays to itself. Or it's a language that plays to its strengths. I love this song too.
Me too. This whole era is just it was such like a...
Can you... I thought it would go on forever.
Yeah. I was hoping it would.
It kind of... It's weird though, but you look at like Diplo and he's taken these ideas and just... you know, further evolved and evolved them, but in some ways they get more pure and more abstract. Something like Major Lazer tracks these ideas, you know, literally back to Jamaica and then
yeah.
fucking working with fucking Skrillex to make crazy pop songs too. So I guess we're just seeing the stuff grow in front of our eyes, but we're...
Have you worked much with clothing though?
A little bit. Transfixed with this. I've done some cool collaborations. Some things that come to mind. I've lucked out a couple times. These were cool.
Mm-hmm.
I did a cool t-shirt with him. Oh well, can't find it.
When was this?
2010 maybe?
Mm-hmm.
What are other cool fashion things? Oh, there it is. They made this amazing embroidered.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, fucking lucky to have.
What is it? The significance of that shape? Because I feel like it frequently shows up in your work.
Yeah, definitely. Growing up, so I had video games. I had BMX and skate, more BMX.
Uh huh.
And then two really important things because we didn't have cable, if you can fucking believe it. So anything they would show on PBS, which is like public television,
yeah.
was really important.
Oh, wow, that's crazy.
So, yeah, there was this thing called K-9. And yeah, I was just kind of, as a child, of course, obsessed with it. And so, yeah, my little dog is just a direct kind of celebration of this little guy. Everyone hated him at the time. They thought it was like dumbing down Doctor Who and making it for kids. I guess they were totally right. But,
wow, this is, like, so special.
I know, it's crazy. Whoa, look at that. The fucking dog collar. It's so beautiful.
I want one.
Holy shit, you're right. We're at the age where we can afford these. The first K-9 was, black and white. Spaceballs, Ben Jones. And then he became color... for this show I did in Greece. The first time I colored him, because we made him out of marble.
Uh-huh.
And then at some point we were just drawing him. My assistant, I don't know why, maybe we were gonna make bricks out of that or something. And I came in, I was like, no, that's the new thing. Such a great color combination. Yeah, this is a great show.
Yeah, the dog is just kind of like your one of your calling cards. Do you give him a name for yourself?
I think, yeah, we call him K69. Of course. In the show, what do we have to call him? K66? No, K99.
Okay.
K999. Like the devil?
9999.
Okay, 9999. And for Problem Solver, because he was on Problem Solvers, Jaleel White, TV's Urkel, and Son of a Hedgehog did the voice. Yeah, I worked with this crazy kind of guy who had this sculpture foundry. Uh-huh. And it was kind of him who inspired that opportunity. But yeah, I think marble is an interesting surface, I think, for primitive geometry.
Yeah.
I think it really heightens that and makes it beautiful, something more than it is, more than the sum of the parts. This is a pop-up store I did for Absolute Vodka and Family Books.
Where was this at Family?
It was in New York. Weirdly enough, they were like, New York, they were like, Family, come to New York and make a little pop-up. And they made this amazing space that had like poetry and art and readings and performance. And I just helped do some of the furniture.
Mm-hmm. This reminds me so much of my childhood.
That's exactly what you would want in an animation studio. Yeah, and a lot of this work was made in like Western Massachusetts and Providence, Rhode Island.
Yeah.
Very East Coast, and we would do a lot of work in the galleries in New York. And then at some point, you know, working with Adult Swim on the pilot for Neon Knome, the guy who runs this whole amazing space, Nick Weidenfeld, you know, it's like, hey, there's this stuff out in LA called the animation industry. You know, you might want to take that into account as you're trying to make a TV show, and encouraged me to entertain moving out here. And a bunch of people were moving out, including Jeffrey Deitch, who I was working with in New York. And yeah, it was kind of a crazy coincidental mass exodus to LA. And that's where Problem Solver started. And a lot of other amazing collaborations. You know, I've always worked in a very collaborative, with a very collaborative approach to the different projects and ideas and visions. And coming out here, it's like an industry that relies on that in an amazing way, and does more than rely on it. It's built because of that, and I guess it can suck sometimes, but it's also does amazing things like Star Wars or Chinatown. So learning that, it was kind of a very steep learning curve to be able to meet all these amazing people, but I actually went back to the very community that, you know, started all of this with zines, and I was like able to reach out to Family Books, and they introduced me to people like John Pham, and John Pham introduced me to people like himself. And yeah, we've slowly kind of got this amazing community of, you know, first and foremost artists and visionaries and world builders. And that's 100% Stone Quackers as a result of that spirit, the collaborative spirit, and specifically of the community. Like, I don't think, and for the better, I don't think I've like really drew a single thing after a certain point on Stone Quackers. Like, it was entirely all these amazing background artists, Max, Carey, Alvin, Haley, I'm sure I'm forgetting people, and amazing character design people, Mark and Chris and Aaron, Garrett. And yeah, there's just like, it's gone from Paper Rad being like this three-person weird thing happening in a bedroom to just an amazing studio working with, you know, collaborative people like John C. Reilly and Heather Lawless and Wit and Clay and Bud. And it's just grown, you know, these visions and these internet psychedelic cartoons have been able to really grow and evolve with the help of amazingly talented people.
And what is the origins of Paper Rad in regards to like forming your aesthetics?
Yeah, again, that's another chicken or the egg, but
conceptually, you guys are the the egg, the spawned chicken.
No, but
you're the chicken that you're the chicken that spawned the egg that is all the.
But it's very difficult because I was in a group called Paper Radio, and Paper Radio was a direct result of things like, you know, Dungeons and Dragons and Transformers and growing up in that culture. And from that work, Paper Rad, I just met these two people who loved Paper Radio, and that work got reimagined with a lot more computers. Yeah. Like, Paper Radio was very much a hand-drawn, handmade, black and white experience. And with Jessica and Jacob, they were just, they kind of were playing around with computers, which I was at the same time, but Paper Radio, again, was more of
the
like...
The pterodactyl to the chicken?
Yes. But then it's like this constant back and forth because, yeah, absolutely, Paper Rad was the first place these ideas happened, but those ideas were happening in different ways with Paper Radio, and when Paper Rad happened, that kind of informed... or hopefully added to what was going on that was ultimately totally inspiring us in Providence, which was Four Thunder and Force Field and Lightning Bolt. And, you know, I think that we were almost the majority of the time just trying to add to what they were doing. And so, yeah, it's definitely the birthplace of a lot of ideas, but at the same time, those ideas were out there, and we were really just trying to catch them in our butterfly nets and play with them like neon noise trolls, new rave neon noise trolls.
Anything you want to tell the internet world?
I'm just really glad that you met Wit when he was
innocent.
Lonely.
He was lonely?
I don't think so.
Oh.
He has a lot of funny stories from that time, like delivering groceries. Maybe that's a little bit after that time, but...
It's really just...
Any story of Wit's is funny.
I feel like I would have met Wit, like, now, and then it would have been normal or something. We would have met...
I agree, yes.
A zillion ways, but we just happened to meet at City College.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's how I feel about Paper Rad, too, and... Stone Quackers and everybody. Yeah, there's something... There's a crystal vibration to the way humans interact and meet and work together. And if you're open to having your crystal resonate at the proper frequency, you'll meet other beautiful crystals.
Yeah, my crystal's pretty vibrant and old.
Rock hard.
Rock hard and pulse. Okay, we're done.
Cut!
Cut.
Cut.
All right. Good night, kids.